May the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts always be pleasing in your sight. Lord God, you are our rock and our redeemer. Happy New Year. Happy Advent. Today marks, as I said to the children, the beginning of something new, a new season, when we as the church prepare for the coming of Christ. A season when we hear again the church's emphasis on hope and on future. A season when we move from the darkness of yesterday and prepare for a new light. And part of what we do during the season is to prepare to celebrate, of course, the coming of Jesus as a baby in Bethlehem. But that is not actually where we start at the beginning of Advent. Strangely enough, we start not at the beginning of the story, but we start at what will be the end of the story. And really, when you think about it, that's not a foreign concept to us. We're kind of used to setting goals. It's what we do as people. Athletes picture themselves, vision themselves, crossing that finish line, winning the gold medal, hoisting the Stanley Cup, or maybe today the Grey Cup. Financial advisors advise you to have a picture of your retirement, a picture of your future, so you can plan, so you can make preparations for that. No one says just wander off aimlessly and whatever happens, happens. Nice to do sometimes, but not really where we want to go. The picture offered in today's first reading from Isaiah is a beautiful one. In the days to come, says Isaiah, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the highest of the mountains, and it shall be raised above all the hills. All nations shall stream to that house. Many people will come and say, come, let us all go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. And how will we know that we've arrived? Well, perhaps this picture may help us see what that looks like more clearly. Many centuries ago, a rabbi was asking his students how they could tell when the night was past and the day was on its way back again. One said, well, when you see an animal in the distance and you can tell if it's a sheep or a goat, then you know it is a new day. Another said, when you can see a tree in the distance and you can tell whether it is a peach tree or a fig tree, then you know that a new day is dawning. But the teacher said, no. You will know the night is passing and a new day is here when you can look into the face of another human being and see there the face of your brother or your sister. Because if you cannot do this, then no matter what time of day it is, for you, it is still night. Someday, this is the future that awaits us. God's future for us. People from all over the world gathered together, worshiping one God. No more war, no more division, swords beaten into plowshares, a beautiful vision of the future, a future of hope. And we begin Advent in this season today, proclaiming hope, a season to remind us that we worship the God of things that are not yet, the God of things that will be. Advent is the season to hold out before us visions of things that, quite frankly, may seem impossible. Advent images like today's of weapons of war turned into producing food. A lion lying snuggled up with a lamb. Light that the darkness will never quench. A child born of a virgin, whose name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And the church dangles all these images today and all through these next 4 weeks. But the church doesn't do it in some grumpy protest against all the prevalent images of Christmas in our culture. Christian hope is not and never has been about looking back or pointing fingers or blaming what is. Christian hope is big and it is bold, and sometimes our hope fails because of lack of imagination or lack of courage or because we fritter away our hope on small, private things, such as a peaceful moment for ourselves, which is good, and we need that, but not as compelling as the idea of peace for the entire world, big, bold Christian hope. But if we're being honest, it is hard to hope big, isn't it? Sometimes our hopes seem doomed, or they just kind of sound foolish. Can we really hope for swords to be beaten into plowshares, really? Is it just wishful thinking to believe that terrorism will turn to joyous acceptance? Or all the people's hatred of one another can actually turn into love for one another? Is it realistic to look for the Son of Man showing up when we least expect it? To pull a halt to all the pain and boredom and stress or evil or tension of everyday life so that God's peace can begin again? Really? It's easy to think so when we look into our past. Either the past as it actually happened or the past as we imagined it was. Isn't that part of what causes a lot of disappointment and discouragement among people? And even so many during the secular Christmas season. Nothing we can do to live up to the way things once were, or how we believed they once were. Nothing we've experienced has lived up to it the way it should have been. But thankfully, we can find some advice. I was going to Devonshire Mall this past week, and I have a habit of parking in the same spot every time I go to the mall. It's the Anglican. I go to the same spot. That's where I park. And I go into next to the Chapters, through the Starbucks entrance. And I cut through Chapters and I enter into the mall that way. But every time I do so, I have to walk by all the magazine racks and Chapters. And one caught my eye this last couple of weeks as I walked by. It said, "Top three ways to navigate the holidays." And actually, quite honestly, when I cracked the magazine open, it actually had some sound advice. It said, set more attainable goals for yourself. Okay. Learn from what you did in the past, from past Christmases. And be more realistic about what's actually possible for you at Christmas. You know, the truth is, the church, in our observance of Advent together, advises exactly the same things. But not so we can just navigate or get through Advent, but so that we can live into God's hope for all of God's creation. This is much bigger than a one-day event. The results we anticipate by observing Advent this way aren't small exceptions, they're bigger ones. Not limited hopes, big, big hopes. We become people who dream of those swords being turned into plowshares, lions and lambs lying down together. We hope for world peace. We hope for walls coming down. Not as wishful thinking, but as something we're actually expecting God to accomplish in God's creation. Paul says in his letter to the church in Rome, first and foremost, set yourself some attainable goals, church. Lay aside the works of darkness. Put on the armor of light. We can do that. In other words, choose compassion over judgment, peace over arguing, acceptance over ostracizing. Let Christ transform us into people who love one another. We can learn from our past. Open our scriptures. The Bible is a record of divine promises made and kept. God, who was faithful in the past, is faithful today and will be faithful in the future. And we are free to give up our obsessions we have with the past, or our past wounds, our anxieties, our hurts and fears and doubts, so that we can live currently in the present, here, now, knowing the God that did and is doing will do again. God keeps God's promises. We are realistic about what is possible. Trusting in God, we are realistic when we hope for things yet unseen, even big things, like joy and peace and salvation and wholeness. I invite you to take part in that over these next 4 weeks out in the Narthex table or booklets called Transformed by Grace, daily reflections where you can take 5 to 10 minutes a day enter into the story of our ancestors of the faith and the story of God and Holy Scripture and find where God was faithful and then look outside and see where God is being faithful today. And the only way to do that is to crack it open, look at it, and then see. We can do that. We can be realistic in knowing that all the things lie ahead of us. Like I tell my 20-year-old son, who was in college, and today he wants a house, and money, and a career, and a car, and a dog, and all to be well. It's all got to be taking place right now. And what do I say? Son, it will come. It will come. We are no different as the church. We want it today. We long for it today. We need it today. God says, it will come. That's why the Advent season and our Christian faith is future-oriented. Yes, Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem. Everything that happened in the past, his birth, his life, his death, his resurrection, his ascension, all happened. But it happened so that we can live into a future that awaits us, a future that God is preparing for us, a future of which Christ, raised from the dead, is that first fruit. He's the first one. Hoping for the future is Advent hope. Realistic, possible, practical hope. Because God is the God who holds the future. It's God's future, not ours. God is the one preparing you and me for that future. God is the one calling us into that future, using prophets and wise people from every generation. And yes, even God's own Son coming to us in a manger, in a barn, in the middle of the night, as an infant. God brings that to the world and dangles these Advent images before us that we continue to hear. Our appetite gets wet so that we can look forward to and hope for that great Christmas. Because there will come a day when swords will be turned into plowshares, spears into pruning hooks, lions will lie down with the lamb, and there will come a day when a virgin shall give birth and bear a son, and we shall call him Emmanuel, God with us. My prayer for all of us is that this Advent season be one of renewed hope for you, for the ones you love, and that as you walk in anticipation of the new life that God promises for you, your family, your church, and God's glory, that you will walk in hope, in light, knowing that that day will come. Happy Advent. Thank you.